Now we come to the next presentation. The next presentation comes from Edwin van Espen from Port of Rotterdam International, which is responsible for the international investments of the Port of Rotterdam Authority. He will show how to become a future-proof port. And as we are in an Africa-focused conference, I'm really excited to learn from Edwin what are also the Africa-specific challenges to become a future-proof port. So Edwin, thanks for being here. The floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you for giving me this opportunity. I hope my slides are visible. And I would like first to introduce you to the Port of Rotterdam, then talk a little bit about our international activities and our outlook on the world. And from there, we extracted our vision on how a future-proof port should look like, and even more importantly, how a organization attached to it should behave. So first, this is where we are. We're in the center of Europe. And by the yellow circles, you can see the hinterland. And we have a very broad definition of hinterland. As you can see, we define ourselves as a European port, not only as a Dutch port. And by those circles, you can see our hinterland. So up to 800 kilometers, roughly, our hinterland is by truck. You see the Yellow River going all the way to Austria by barges. You see the train. And what is also really important, you see another circle for the short sea. Because 40% of the containers coming into Port of Rotterdam, 40% of them, they're going out again by short sea. This is the port itself. It's 45 kilometers long. It is an enabler of a lot of jobs, and that accumulates in a contribution to the Dutch GDP of 6.3%. That's 45 billion euro. And that is an enormous contribution that we have to the national economy. This also shows how important ports and the connected networks are for countries. So we calculated to have a precise number, and we came up to 6.3%. Actually, we didn't calculate it, but an independent university in the Netherlands calculated this number. From the several different colors, you can see that we have a lot of different activities clustered together. So we are a port, but we are also an industrial area, and that helps each other. So it's a very efficient way to produce things, to import and export raw materials and products. So we always say that we are a port and industrial area. That's very important to mention also. Here's some more numbers why we are the gateway to Europe. This number for 2020 will actually be, we think, around 10% lower due to the COVID crisis. At first, we thought we're going to have a hit of minus 20%, but we are recovering quite fast, I have to say, in the last couple of months. And we now, we think we're going to have a year end of minus 10%, which is still 45 to 50 million ton less than usual. But hopefully the next year we will we go back to the 470 or higher. And there you see a ranking of our friends and colleagues and competitors. Sometimes that goes together. Hamburg is there, number four, I think. And then another Dutch port, Amsterdam, is there. Well, you can see it by himself. So by far, we are the gateway to Europe in terms of volume. On the right, you see a breakdown how that is built up. What is important to mention is the liquid bulk here. A lot of that is oil-related products. We're also active internationally. We have, this is a bit of a secret. We are a joint venture partner in a port in Oman in the Middle East. Already for 15 years, we've been there managing the port together with the Omani government. That has been very successful. And in those 15 years, $25 billion are invested. And it's one of the fastest growing hubs in the Middle East. So we actually learn a lot from being in the Middle East and being in a different environment, but it's turned out to be quite successful. And we're repeating that in Brazil, in the north of Brazil. We are joint venturing with not the federal government, but with the state government. And there we are in the port of Pecém. where we have a very interesting target, very ambitious target, because in 2030 we want to have more than double the volume. So that means you have to be really future proof to make sure this is going to happen. We also do advisory services. We're not a regular consultant. We like to help ports and governments that are more of a partnership. And then we look at the port in these three different spheres, as it is. So we take a strategic look at the port, so the long term from master planning point of view, and also how it is structured. We look at the hardcore port management processes, so the nautical processes that are there, asset management, engineering, commercial, so the real port-related procedures, how you deal with your terminals. And we look at development, and there we have education and training as a very important element. And of the last couple of years, also innovation and digitization is there. Now, if we accumulate those experiences, how do we think a future-proof port should look like? And of course, you have to tweak it to your local situation, but these building blocks we think should be central around that future port. What is driving it? Well, this is something we see all over the world. So we see shifting trade patterns. Of late, the last couple of years, this is shifting quite rapidly, I have to say. And as a port, you have to be prepared and you have to see what is going to happen. Because yeah, you have fixed assets. So how do you capture, how do you keep your existing cargo, and how do you capture the new cargo? That is a basic skill you should have. Another development that we see is the energy transition. So less CO2 and emergence of new resources, going away from oil and gas to new energy carriers. Digitization, everything is becoming data-driven, and I mean literally everything, and real-time. And I think ports are lacking behind there also when it comes to digitization, but it's there to stay, and it's actually increasing. And innovation, business disruptions are actually happening all over the world. And we should be prepared for that. So we should be comfortable with a changing situation. You should be very curious to what you can see as an opportunity there when things are changing. And of course, of late, we have the COVID-19, where it actually has shown us in Oman, Brazil, in the Netherlands, how dependent we are on technology and how it actually can help us, especially digitally, to keep your industry running. Another side effect of this crisis that there is an increased level of uncertainty, and ports have to be even more efficient than usually they looked at, because budgets are going down and performance has to go up. Now then we go to the actual building blocks. It's a bit of an open door, but it starts with the people. So it starts with your organization. You have to have flexible people, open-minded people, who can be very critical to look at themselves, but to also look at your clients. A port is that not there by itself. It's there to serve terminals, shipping industry, but also the whole ecosystem that goes around that. And you have to be very much in touch with what they want and in the direction they want to go and what the problems are that they are facing. So you have to be very open-minded and reaching out to your stakeholders that you're having. And you have to be capable of working with different organizations and cultures and backgrounds. So that is a rule number one. And related to that, you have to have a good governance model, a fit for purpose governance model. And later I will show you what we see in the world, what is the new governance model that is becoming very dominant. And that's this one. I personally don't like the name landlord, to be honest, because it's a bit of a hierarchy. But if you look at the picture, the blue is what we think a landlord model, like a port company, should do. So we have the basic infrastructure. We dredge the port, we do the maintenance. But increasingly, we are also supporting the overarching activities like digital developments, port community systems, just to cater and to facilitate the actual companies that you see here in white. So these are the private sector companies, terminals, refineries, shipping lines. And together you make the port ecosystem. So one cannot go without the other one. So we invest in the basic infrastructure and in innovations. And the on top of that, the private sector invests in their own assets, people, and what have you. And this is a very good model that we're now seeing emerging all over the world. It gives focus, and it also shows you where to invest and where to develop your skills. The building block number two is asset management. We sometimes forget, but we're always focusing on projects. But once you've built it and you add everything up, on your balance sheet, you have billions of dollars of investment standing there. And you better be taking care of it. Because if you don't do that, you actually destroying value. So we are seeing here a very strong shift also in predictable and preemptive maintenance, also data-driven. And that's a complete shift from how it was done before. In the past, it was waiting until things deteriorate, and now you want to be preemptive and already take action before you see something deteriorate. And that can only be if you do data-driven and also model-driven. All this is done to expand the lifespan, but even more important, to have adaptive use. So you cannot just build a key wall for one customer. You have to sometimes take other types of use into account. And it's very much linked with the digital infrastructure. More and more it's overlapping. You have concepts as the digital twin, whereby you have the exact copy of your port completely digital, so you can run models there and simulations. And the Internet of Things. So the infrastructure more and more is equipped with sensors and real-time measurements that are linked to your digital twin. So you have a virtual reality of your port that you can use in, for optimization. One of the recent developments that we are doing is optimized dredging, whereby we make a combination of information where the ships actually, with a certain draft, have been, how deep it is, but also when we have a certain dredgers there, what is the actual performance of dredging. So you see a very interesting combination of a port company, the Port of Rotterdam, together with IHC, which is actually they're building dredging equipment. And if we combine our technology, you have a very clear overview of your dredging performance of contractors in your port. And especially when the river ports, millions and millions of dollars can be monitored. And even if you improve the efficiency with a couple of percentage points, you make a huge saving here. So it's a very important tool and something completely new, because in a couple of years ago, we could not imagine that we as a port company would work together with a dredging equipment builder. So an interesting example. Brings me to the infrastructure and the connections. Also here you see an almost melting of the physical infrastructure and the digital infrastructure across the chain. So whereby we first were looking only at automation within the port, we're now looking at across the chain to even ports of departure, how the vessels are behaving, how the cargo is behaving, and it's all becoming an integrated overview of all these movements across the chain. Another thing that is going very rapidly here is the emergence of autonomous vessels. And to be honest, for a large part, vessels are already autonomous. Only the last bit or the first part in the port is a bit of a challenge. But also there you see now that autonomous vessels are emerging quite fast. And that goes even for trains, for trucks and barges. That also means that a lot of decisions have to be taken in real time. And that is almost impossible for a human being to do. So those real-time communications are so integrated across the chain, you need to have and rely on your artificial intelligence to automate your process. And we actually started with our own artificial intelligence captain, it's a floating lab. And it's actually the software is learning how to maneuver a vessel. This is one of our own patrol boats. And it's not that we're gonna sell this type of software, but as a port, we want to be prepared that if vessels like this start to appear, and that they're already there, some of them, we need to be ready as a port, what is going to happen technically, but also from an insurance point of view or legal point of view, we need to be fully prepared and be a front runner so we can receive those vessels when they are there. Then number four, the environment and stakeholder engagement. Very important. You saw the 6.3% of GDP. Jobs are one of the main drivers when we take decisions. Of course, we look at efficiency and we look at vessels and things like that. But what is also very important is job creation and to make sure that the jobs stay relevant. As you go into the digitization age, a lot of jobs are disappearing or changing. That also goes very rapidly. And in order to be part of that and to be prepared, we now have almost a very deep collaboration with educational and training institutes to make sure that the people in the port and also in our company are prepared for those changes. And that brings me to another very important line of thought, is that we go for profit optimization and not for maximization. So we need to make money in order to finance these investments. That is rule number one. But sometimes we choose to go for spending money on an education program, or sometimes we want to have a terminal that generates a lot of jobs and a little bit less of profit, just to make sure that you stay relevant for the people that are working in your port. One of our mission statements is also that we want to create economical and social value. And that together has to result in sustainable growth. And we believe that this is a future-proof model. So we don't go for the quick bucks and then see what happens. No, we want to have a sustainable development plan. One of the examples is that we are part of the World Ports Climate Action Program. I'm not sure if it's well known in Africa. Actually, if you want to be a front runner when it comes to climate action, please join. You can see that some other ports are already there, and a lot of different topics are being discussed here, like electricity provision from ship to shore, to alternative fuels. We have different programs where those ports are actually a driving force and want to be a front runner in it when it comes to climate action. Then we go to energy, linked to the environment. You could see in the overview I gave that 50% of our volume is fossil-based oil and gas. And we think that over a period of 20 to 30 years, this will go down relatively quickly. Already the coal, demand for coal is going down fast. And not that far in the future, we believe that oil and gas will also start declining, although probably it will still be used for the next 20 years. But you see that there is a lot of pressure on using it. And then when we look at the port, in our case, we have five refineries in our port. It's going to mean something in terms of volumes and investments. So we are actively looking for different business models that we want to have in our port, such as the green biofuels that are there. Biochemicals that are there. So we also invite sometimes smaller pilot plants to our port and to our industrial area to see if they can grow into a new business model, all because of the changes that are there. And one of the changes that is very promising also for Africa is the potential of hydrogen. If you produce it in a green way, so if you use wind and solar energy, you can produce large volumes of hydrogen, which can be shipped in different forms to Europe, for example, or to Japan. Australia is looking to shipping it to Japan. I think if you look to Africa, it would be very interesting to look at Asia, but especially to Europe, whereby because of the Paris Climate Accord, people are actually willing to pay a little bit more for CO2-free energy. And hydrogen is actually one of the new energy carriers who can fulfill the potential. We are just embarking on this journey. And we recently also joined the African Hydrogen Partnership that is currently being established. and they want to stimulate the production, the local use, and also the export of hydrogen in Africa. So it's a very interesting commodity that we believe is going to be play a very big role in the future, especially when it comes to the energy consumption in Europe. So a very good chance for Africa, and also for port and industry Africa and industrial areas in Africa, to use it locally and to start exporting it to Europe and other parts of the world. So this is actually the one of the goals that we are setting to ourselves. On the right, you see a huge yellow triangle. That is actually what needs to be imported from 2030 up to 2050 in terms of volumes of hydrogen. So a huge potential. How do we know that we have that these are the volumes that we have to import? Well, it's simply calculating back. If you want to lower your CO2 emissions, you need to have an alternative for the oil and gas, which is hydrogen. And then if you calculate how much energy hydrogen can contain, you can actually see how much volume you should import. So very, very interesting chance, I would say, for Africa and African ports. Then, of course, the digital transition. We cannot stay away from that. It's going to a direction where business to business is connected, government to government is connected, business to government is connected, changing roles, all kinds of new players coming up. We ourselves are very active in the port community system, the paperless process that go along with it. We are active in port call optimization, whereby we use artificial intelligence to predict when the vessel will reach the port. And we can also advise the vessel on the speed it should have to reach a certain slot. And only by that feature, by advising on the speed, you can save thousands of dollars per day, because a lot of vessels, they go too fast. And when they are close to the port, they have to wait. So if you make that, if you optimize it, if you can give an exact slot and an exact optimum speed when the vessel is there and how you can plan it into your port and terminals, because this port call optimization is also integrating with schedules of terminals, of bunkering, of tugboats, then you have a very smooth process, and you can actually do a lot more with the same infrastructure. So it is good for the environment, you have less emissions, less costs, and it optimizes your existing infrastructure. So a very interesting one. We're also looking at cargo trackers, booking platforms, blockchain initiatives we are very much involved in. And I think only on this slide, maybe I can talk for 3 days, but it's just to give you a gist of the developments that we are involved and that we believe that will be shaping the future. Here is an example. On the right, we have our port community system. Our own port community system is for, I think, 8 ports in the Netherlands. So it's actually the now being used as a national system, but it's also modular. So if a port doesn't want to have a very complex functionality, we can also have the basic functionality there. But if we have 30,000 seagoing vessels per year in Rotterdam, so we have the full-fledged port community system. And we are now making it in such a way that you can actually link it with, for example, the track and trace, what you see on the left, the blockchain, the IoT, port call optimization software I'm talking about. So we try to build those links to make sure that your port community system can keep on evolving and is not just fixed, set in stone. What you also see a lot in the port community system that the business to the government to business is not always optimized very well, because people don't trust each other on how the data is handled and how the data will be used. So we put a lot of effort in our port community system to make sure that the right parties and people can access the right information, and that there are very strict firewalls between information that is sensitive, either from a legal point of view, but also from a commercial point of view. You don't want to have the competitors being able to see each other's data. So we spend a lot of time in making sure that that could not happen. So for the future, you need a very good port community system, be able to connect with those developments that are there. But also you should be able to maybe in the future to connect your port community system between ports so they can actually talk to each other and exchange information. Then the last one, innovation. One of the small examples is that we were working with the dredging equipment builder, but there are a lot of other examples, and we actually seen that as a port, as a port company, you can be able to make sure that your scale-ups and startups come to your port industrial complex and come up with new ideas. You really have to put a lot of energy on attracting them, but once you have them, you're creating a culture of continuous improvement. And we were able to harness that in a certain model that evolved in the last couple of years. So the first part is we're working together with universities and with knowledge institutes, research. So that is the first part. The second part are the local innovations. So in this case, from the Netherlands. So you have business ideas that are validated. There is an organization looking after those innovations to make sure that they actually can experiment and become a startup. The same we're doing with Port Excel. That's now becoming a foundation of 15 different members. And they are looking for startups worldwide. And they can even connect international startups with other ports globally. So we went from a local an innovation environment to an international innovation environment. And then the last part is the port fund, whereby we, there is an investment in startup and scale-ups that come from Port Innovation Lab and from Port Excel. If you really want to have that idea or that company in your port, we are enabling the investors to make sure that the company can go for full potential, and you can buy shares or support it in another way that it grows into your port, and that you actually have the change that you want in your own port. So this is a very interesting method, of course, but it comes down on how to mobilize the new ideas and how to keep them relevant into your port. And on top you can see the subjects that we're looking at. So we look at maritime industry. The artificial intelligence for vessels is an example. We have chemicals and refinery, because 50% of our volume is linked to that. Energy is there, and of course transport and logistics. So these topics are featured in this scheme below us, in this ecosystem. So these are examples of the Port Excel. So autonomous shipping and the Internet of Things. They're having, I think, 30 or 40 different startups yearly from all over the world working on new ideas. So what do we capture? So it's a very broad topic, of course, on how to become a future-proof port. But the main message is you have to continually adapt and manage. If you cannot do that, you're going to be in a very tough spot, and soon you will not be relevant anymore as a port company. So you need to consciously adapt and be aware of the changes that are going to affect you. But it's also an opportunity. And we formulated the opportunity in line with the Sustainable Development Goals by the United Nations. And all what we do, so all the improvements that we make and our future outlook, is to make sure that we can actually fulfill a certain set of the Sustainable Development Goals. You can see them here. It's very ambitious. But we think with the building blocks that I've shown you and the actual examples and work that we are doing, that we can actually reach there. And this is also something that we would like to do with partners all over the world, and especially also in Africa. Thank you for listening to this. And are there any questions?
Thank you, Edwin, for this presentation. Let's see if we have questions from the audience. Yes, we have one. From Lars Greiner. For an African port, what do you recommend are the first steps to start future-proofing in existing ports? Or maybe I can add something to this question. How do you consider Africa-specific conditions in your concept? If there are, for example, lower labor costs, imbalance in export, more customs rules or more customs inspections, or more governmental impacts and influence in port operations, or challenging hinterland connections. How do you consider these issues in making an African port and a future-proof port?
Well, but it's a very localized situation, of course, that you have to study. A port in Egypt is not the same as a port in South Africa or in Nigeria. So we do have certain methodologies to scan the environment. But what we usually see is we have to start with how the governance structure, how that is done, what responsibilities and goals are you setting, where do you invest in, what type of skills are you developing, and how much power do your shareholders have? Is it a government company, is it a private company, or is it a concession? So a lot of these processes, we start with looking at the governance model and to see if we can optimize those governance models. And then very quickly you run into all kinds of other analysis that go about terminals efficiency, about opportunities in your hinterland. But I would say it first starts with a good analysis of your governance model.
Okay, thank you, Edwin. I think we do not have any further questions. So ladies and gentlemen, we had three very interesting presentations today about port privatization, artificial intelligence, and proof ports. I think we learned a lot. Thank you all so much for presenting, listening, asking, and answering. It was a pleasure to be with you here. I hope to see you later or tomorrow in the virtual space of this interesting conference. Anyhow, it was so interesting that I already look forward to the next virtual ports and logistics summit. Well, I just see there's another question coming up from Gaia Gassen again. A few seconds ago, he asked, what are main conditions you think for Mediterranean African countries should have? Well, this is the questions very similar to those ones we asked before.
It is very strange.
Do you see any specific issues for the Mediterranean Sea?
I think the Mediterranean African countries, they have a very good opportunity for seeing developments in containers to be for the short sea elements, but also for hydrogen. If you combine the industrial parts of producing hydrogen and you're close to Europe, then to be a future-proof port, I would deeply look into that opportunity together with the local government.
Okay, thank you. So we are quite late now. So I was just already starting to introduce the closing remarks, which were done by Rahat. So thank you to all of us. Now I hand over for closing remarks to us again. Thank you. Goodbye. Stay healthy.